The patient is actually probably the most important tool song to me personally. My main power animal is a cheetah. I like to speed through things, I go very quickly, I don't have patience for other people taking forever. When were they really not taking forever? They're just taking longer than I would, or, you know. And then there's also, you blow through things so quickly that you miss a lot along the way. And so I actually have, I must keep reminding myself of this, tattooed on my arm. It's my most visible tattoo. It's one that I see every day, one that I really need.
That to me is the most important part. If we get any spiritual guidance out of this other than, you know, being patient itself, is that if you perpetually remind yourself to be patient, it's almost like a perpetual release of stress. You know, like you get to hold on to that patience and actually get to open up to all those things.
Yeah. Ooh, brother, I used to have insane panic attacks.
It's only temporary, right?
So if you open up to be the patient, you can actually fix yourself.
Mm-hmm. So, Eon Blue Apocalypse, I think this is hilarious, dude. Okay, on the Tool Shed site where I get all these lyrics from, it just says, there are no words. And no, there aren't. But damn it, there are words to say about it. And there are feelings that come with it. And there's so much more than words. And when I saw them play it in Oklahoma City, I knew that the patient was coming. And I thought that I was just going to cry through the whole time that they played the patient. And I didn't at all, not during the patient. But I sobbed my eyes out to this because you pull away that cornerstone, and then what do? Everything is falling down. This is your personal apocalypse. Are you getting out of here? Okay. Thank you for bringing the speaker.
It's the JP Apocalypse.
Good luck at your show tonight.
I'll do the darn.
For everyone on the internet, this is JP. He plays guitar for the metal band Wraith.
AKA Splooge Jack.
We're going to make him famous. Woo!
Yeah. Are any of those guys from Brian?
Something presumably famous. No, they're from Cersei.
Ben Wraith played in my late senior talent show.
I'm glad that I'm going to get all this advertising on the video.
Yeah.
Check out Wraith, guys.
He's rad enough to bring us a speaker every week for free. So yeah, there's a desperation in this song. After we let go of our cornerstone, does it all fall down? Are we stripped to our foundations? Where do we go from there? Sometimes when we remove the grudge against others and ourselves, we are left vulnerable to abuse, confusion, or being taken advantage of. And other times we simply feel alone or isolated, like we're the only ones waking up. Eon Blue is the name of a chat room on the official tool site. Eon is also mentioned by name in a post to the official site on February 19th, 2001, regarding Adam's 190-pound Great Dane. Ridiculously huge dog.
How big is Tinkerbell?
Tank is only 85
or 80.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Yeah, and she's a little skinny for a Great Dane.
Yeah.
But.
So two Tinkerbells.
Yeah, two. Two Tinkerbells. And Eon, the dog, as I mentioned earlier, actually died of cancer, which is an interesting relation to follow up with the patient. So with the patient, we get this whole grown-up tedium, you wait it out, he even sighs in the song, like there just isn't even a word for this. So the introduction, this is the introduction of a kind of questioning attitude. Is this a test? And what questions would be on a life test? Like if God were challenging you, what would he be testing you for? What if you learned recently that you can apply new knowledge to this exam? So where is this experience coming from? What skills of mine are being challenged and how can I hone them? How can you face the situation in a way that is in your best interests and the best interests of those around you? What have I faced in the past that would allow me to better handle this situation? As we release the grudge and begin the process of healing, we become our own healers and our own patients. Here, the character is shedding anxiety, paranoid, paralyzed, kind of body of anxiety. One fan also suggested that Tool fans are patients of Tool, and this song is about the nature of being a rock star. Simply put, it could also be about the band's personal experience of dealing with each other. The time signature is in 5-4, what is considered by many to be a very uplifting rhythm. Brett and I were actually talking about this with Jack Bruno yesterday, and he brought up the song 15 Step by Radiohead. Is also in 15/4, which for Radiohead is 5/4 speaking. It's like a really upbeat, really uplifting track, especially for Radiohead. What time is it?
No, what song?
15
is
Step.
15 Step, the first track on In Rainbows.
The Gorillas also have a song called 5/4. Just that 5/4.
Yeah.
Say Gorillas?
Yeah. However, with the drums on this track, because I'm really not music theory inclined. I played piano when I was in elementary school, and that was it.
That was definitely meant to sound like a clock.
Yeah, it definitely does sound like a clock, especially in the beginning. But what Jack brought up was that with the drums on the track and the way that they play in relation to the time signature, that's what makes it feels like a ticking clock. It gives you that sense of anticipation for the next beat.
Mm-hmm.
The song itself forces us to be patient with it at the same time that it's giving us hope. We are waiting for someone else to wake up or for ourselves to continue to wake up. This waiting wears on us over time until we become damaged. And the only reason that I kind of use the word damaged there rather than like injured or whatever is because he uses the word damaged in the lyrics. It could definitely be about being patient and waiting for many Tool fans to wake up to what they were really communicating through their music. Everyone grows at their own pace, and you can't expect to change anyone but yourself. All we can do is set the example and be the change we wish to see. Everyone must choose to heal themselves internally rather than force their healing on anyone else in order to change the world. The song offers us a perspective outside of the self and eases the frustrations and impatience in a fast food, instant gratification culture. And it really draws into question how we would handle others who have not released the grudge, not necessarily against you, but in the same sense of releasing their own angers, which we often aren't even aware of until we start to pry our third eyes open and reflect on ourselves. The vampire could also be the manifestation of negative aspects of ourselves, literally taking our blood. It takes time to integrate new lessons, to release old patterns and habits. We will constantly make mistakes, and we will consistently need to release the grudge in each instance. Saturn comes back around. Though this is very difficult, especially at first. We must be patient, even with reminding ourselves to be patient. A huge lesson I've personally embraced from the song is giving myself reminders, whether in the form of a tattoo, a crystal, a piece of art, a piercing, a note, or journal entry, or even in the form of... Oh, no, it's the AC. A note or journal entry, or even in the form of a dream. Because honestly, I'm so far down my path at this point that my subconscious has rooted that reminder of remaining patient as well as other integrated ideas, and they manifest through my dreams to show me what I'm lacking in currently or where I'm kind of dropping the ball or what I need to pay attention to in the future. This song is very relevant to intimate or romantic relationships and the struggle that comes with such deep compassion for someone whose idea of healing may not be the same as your own. That is not to say that they have no desire to heal, just that their definition or their control of healing can't be compromised. One fan theory, this song is very relevant to intimate romantic relationships and the... Oh, that is incorrect. That's what I just read. Sorry. Fan theory, here we go. All or most of Lateralus is about the turmoil within the band and the eventual reconciliation. Ticks and Leeches and The Grudge are songs from Mander's point of view about Adam, Danny, and Justin, although The Grudge may be more about the situation rather than Mander's perspective. Triad is from the point of view of Adam, Danny, and Justin in regards to Mander's absence due to A Perfect Circle. Notice there are no vocals, just the voices of the other members of Tool. The Patient is Mander reassuring the other three members of the band that he didn't want to be in Tool. If he didn't want to be in Tool, he would have left by now. It is also Mander coming to terms with the fact that he can't change the feeling or opinions of the other three. All he can do is continue moving on and have faith that everything will work out. To be patient, my understanding of the Holy Grail is that the patient and disposition are linked in the spiral. The Patient is about being patient and disposition being about the change of perspective of the entire band after coming to an understanding of one another. The songs following these two, Lateralis and Reflection, are in a sense about rebirth and renewed awareness. The songs prior to the patient disposition revolve around anger and discontent, schism, the grudge, and ticks and leeches. In between, in the middle of the spiral, are parable and parabola. Google the Holy Grail and Tool to learn more.
Google.
I posted a status last night about Aleister Crowley, and it just said that this year, December 1st, marks the 65th anniversary of his death. And this dude totally started trolling me. I mean, he got on there and just got onto me for liking Aleister Crowley, even though my status made no claims about my feelings toward him whatsoever. And it was really interesting because he kept throwing all these red herrings into the philosophical debate, like, oh, well, JFK assassination, blah, 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 blah. Like, Google it, Google it, Google it. George W. Bush is the grandson of Aleister Crowley. Google it. Well, you Google it, you get a whole bunch of amateur websites with disclaimers that say this is all conjecture, blah, blah, blah. And it's like, dude, read a book. Like,
yeah, right?
These things are edited and published and fact-checked, and you can't depend on random websites for valid information unless you really know where it's coming from or it's been accredited.
Tell the truth. Google it.
Yeah, Google the truth, right? No, it's ridiculous, but I mean, they say Google the Holy Grail and we'll learn more, and I kind of view Google and search engines more of a gateway. Like, if you're curious about something, look it up. If that intrigues you even more, come to the library. So another fan theory, to me this is the ultimate anti-suicidal, why do I keep going song. If there's nothing that could possibly go good in our lives, why wouldn't I have killed myself long ago? No, there must be something. I just have to go out and find it. That's the feeling I get from the song. And I definitely see that too, that desperation and not knowing what you're still holding on for, what rewards you're waiting for, like how long has it been since you got one, or since you felt rewarded for whatever it is that you're facing. The song also, for me, and I'm sure you guys will see this connection, brings to mind the book of Job in the Bible, which relates the story of Job's trials at the hands of Satan, his discussion with friends on the origins and nature of his suffering, his challenge to God, and finally a response from God. The book is a didactic poem set in a prose frame. The overriding and oft asked question in the book of Job is, why do the righteous suffer? And so it is, the song is a test of faith. And faith also plays a huge role in healing. If you have faith in science, then you have reason to keep going. I mean, it doesn't have to be faith in God. It could just be faith in the self. It is also a clinical metaphor. Many fans seem to think that this song is about a struggle to commit to medical school, though it seems to be a greater metaphor for a commitment to anything. However, I do appreciate the introduction of the medicinal definition, or medical definition, for patient, as it suggests someone who is seeking to rid themselves of dis-ease. And that brings us to mantra and schism. Song's kind of weird.
The screen, it's two paintings of the screen having a conversation together.
Two paintings of the screen having a conversation?
Yeah.
That's cool.
So can you pass the sugar?
So Winston, you weren't here for the last one. Basically, we're just meditating through the songs together, discussing them. We're also going to watch the video. you're gonna hear it twice. Hope you enjoy this. Should play the video with commentary.
Thank you.
Jesse, you want to tell us what time signature that was in?
Time signatures?
Thank you.
See, this is why we need JP.
He provided time signature.
No, JP wouldn't know it.
I forget exactly what it is.
It was a trick question.
It's, yeah, it, I'll talk about it later. It changes time signatures 47 times. Yeah, like, it was a joke. Nobody could tell me what that time signature was. Unless they've memorized all
of them. Most of it's in the 22 time signatures that divide.
Yeah, I think they're... patterns that they cycle through, I think. We'll get there.
Well, hey, I'm just gonna cover, I'm gonna just say, I guess, like, my piece, and then I have to leave to go
okay.
back. But I still remember the first time I heard this song. Man, back in 2001, sitting late night watching MTV, watching the video, and just wondering, like, what was going on, like, on the screen. But, over time, it's, I thought it was about, I guess, like, you know, like, it's obviously, it's like two people trying to come together, but the more I listen to it, I kind of focus in on the aspect of, like, strengthening their communication and being able to really, like, say the hard stuff to other people, because
yes.
that was what's going to bring you together.
Yes.
It's, if you, and it's not, like, leaning more and more to the cold silence, but if you stay having these superficial conversations, you're not going to go anywhere. And you're always going to have that, even that distance in your words between the distance in your hearts. And, you know, even now, like, there's another aspect of, like, you know, unifying contradictions within yourself, like things you want to say and, the things you're ready to admit to yourself and the things you're ready to admit to other people. About why this schism? Why do you think this schism appeared or has caused you to be at such a cold distance to others or a cold distance to yourself? And in that way, I love you all. I'm gonna go back to work.
Love you too, buddy.
But
have a good day.
Rothamet modified, if you have guys don't know. Yeah,
we'll get
the key soon enough.
Actually, before I want to talk about this, I forgot to do this earlier when we were going through the alchemical process. I have 7 herbs in here, which I'll show you later, but if you could just contribute your intention and kind of grind them up a little bit, get them to a powder, I'm going to make a lateralis elixir for everyone. And bring it to the next lecture. If you're not at the next lecture, just ask me. I'll make sure you get some.
I've been doing that the entire time you've been grinding it.
Yeah.
I knew exactly what
yeah.
that was.
Yeah.
It's time.
I'm so bad.
Yeah.
Today.
So, mantra. Okay, so you'll remember Eon Blue Apocalypse, the website said, there are no words. But on this one, it just says dot. Which is hilarious to me.
There are
because,
vocals, they're just not human.
Oh yeah, there are definitely vocals in it. And it's muddled voices of two people trying to speak to one another and neither can hear the other. So the song is actually the same backwards and forwards, which is why I feel like these two people are saying the same thing, but because they can't hear each other, neither is satisfied. So it sounds like muffled voices, attempting to have a conversation, each forgetting to listen, just talking over the other, and perhaps there are words and we just can't understand them. And then a Tool fan found a 2001 interview with Maynard in the Japanese magazine Buzz, where he stated for the first time in public, as a treat for the Japanese, the track mantra is the sound of him squeezing one of his Siamese cats. The cat made such a weird noise that he immediately recorded this, played it real slow, and made a track out of it.
A Siamese cat, nonetheless.
Yeah, Siamese cat. Totally. Twin. And if you go back and listen to the song, it totally sounds like a cat having a really bad time. Yeah.
Veritas, please.
So we get to schism. What is a schism? It's a separation or division into factions, or related to religion, a formal breach of union within a Christian church, or the offense of attempting to produce such a breach. It's also a disunion or discord, which coincidentally, Inanna, the goddess associated with the seven-pointed star, is also eventually associated with Eris in Discordianism, goddess of discord. She's also goddess of the nighttime. Again, yes?
Inanna is also considered the, quote, battle maiden. Mm-hmm. She leads people, is associated with passion, both love and hatred.
Yeah, destruct creation.
Yes, she is the cycle in and of herself.
Mm-hmm.
I was actually wearing a copper and bronze bracelet all yesterday, and while thinking of her for no reason.
Yeah, Schism is the fifth track on the album. The fifth chakra is the throat chakra, also related to the fifth process in alchemy, which is fermentation, which is the two-step process involving two separate entities. So again, we are presented with a conversation between two people or between two aspects of self. Essentially, both are asking for the same thing, but neither can hear the other. Neither can see the line along which the damaged and broken meet in order to heal enough, even though their intentions are identical. Their initial passion ends up burning them before burning out. Even the word science comes from an Indo-European root meaning to cut or to separate. The same root led to the word shit, which of course means to separate living flesh from non-living waste. The same root gave us sight, and scissors, and schism, which have obvious connections to the concept of separation. That was a quote from Snow Crash by Neal Stephenson, which is like one of the greatest science fiction novels ever. You should all read it, definitely. But I remember when I read it the first time, like I knew what a schism was, but I wasn't to the point where I was starting to dive into etymology and like linguistic alchemy, basically, and deconstructing words and finding their roots. So this actually was the quote that opened my eyes to like all of the roots of this word and linguistic alchemy in general. Okay. Yes, this is a time signature. I'm going to read it really fast, and none of you are going to know what I'm talking about. Okay. Schism is renowned for its use of uncommon time signatures and the frequency of its meter changes. In one analysis of the song alters meter 47 times. The song begins with two bars of 5-4, followed by one bar of 4-4, followed by bars of alternating 5-8 and 7-8, until the first interlude, which consists of alternating bars of 6-8 and 7-8. The following verse exhibits a similar pattern to the first, alternating bars of 5-8 and 7-8. The next section is bars of 6-4, followed by one bar of 11-8. This takes the song back into alternating 5-8 and 7-8. Another 6-8 and 7-8 section follows, and after this, the song goes into repeating 7-8 bars. The middle section is subsequently introduced, consisting of three bars of 6-8, one bar of 3-8, and one bar of 3-4, repeating several times. At one point, it interrupts with two bars of 6-8, followed by a bar of 4-8 twice. A bar of 5-8 is played before the meter switches back to 6-8 for two bars, and 2-4 for one bar. This repeats, setting up another section, two bars of 9-8, followed by a bar of 10-8. That pattern again, and then a single bar of 9-8, followed by alternating bars of 6-8 and 7-8. The outro has alternating bars of 5-8 and 7-8, ending with alternating 6-8, 2-8, 2-8, that one could interpret as pulsing with a 4-4 feel. The band is referred to the time signature as 6.58. Although many composers would use 13/16 instead, 6.5/8 is still a valid fractional time signature.
I feel like I just watched an episode of Friends and Fast Forward.
Yeah, right?
Yeah, it's a lot. Like, you are literally listening to a sound manifestation of a schism. Like, what's the name of the thing that you play music into and it gives you, like, the readout? Aphex Twin has a song that he programmed his face into, and when you play it through this program, you can see his face in the sound. You know what I'm talking about? There's also a song about my cats that is just a picture scrolling of this dude's cats. Mm-hmm. Like, nobody, I can't remember what that machine is.
I know what you're talking about.
But like, I can't even imagine what this would look like.
That thing that Adam always uses.
Yeah.
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 it's
somebody on the internet out there will know and will assist me, I'm sure. Okay, so the relevance of this song, there is a relevance to the fall of the Tower of Babylon and the collapse of unified language, but it also presents the idea of mathematical precision as a foundation for communication. I've done the math enough to know the dangers of our second guessing. This has been loosely tied to the Vitruvian Man from Leonardo da Vinci and the proportions contained within the human body. And there's a much longer list than this. These are just the ones that I included for the sake of brevity. The length of the outspread arms is equal to the height of a man. From the hairline at the bottom of the chin, from the hairline to the bottom of the chin is 1/10 the height of a man. From above the chest to the hairline is 1/7 of the height of man. The maximum width of the shoulders is 1/4 of the height of man. The distance from the elbow to the tip of the hand is 1/4 the height of a man. The distance from the elbow to the armpit is 1/8 of the height of a man, and the foot is 1/7 of the height of a man. If you don't know the Vitruvian Man, this is the original image, proportionally. And if you look, the center of the square is at the root, and then the center of the circle is at the navel. If you actually align those two and kind of offset the circle and the square, you actually get a phi ratio that runs over the human body.
Right there, I want to quickly go back.
Which will look like this. This,
yeah.
This is a pentagram of man.
The poetry comes from the squaring off between.
Squaring.
And the circling is worth it. Find beauty in the dissonance. Like, that to me are some of the most profound and divinely accomplished lyrics of all time.
Yeah.
Coming from a metal band.
I wouldn't even call them a metal band anymore. So here's the video. This is probably going to take forever to load. I'm sorry.
I also took schism kind of as kind of a division of the self. You're torn between two sides, or you're just, maybe you see the external point of view, but you also have this internal point of view that's slightly offset.
Yeah, I was thinking about that
too. Does that come through for anybody else?
I was definitely thinking about that while we were listening to it. Just thinking about reconciling two sides of yourself that you're struggling with, you know.
Which is very relevant to Geminis, like us.
Of course.
What it always makes me think of when I actually listen to it, and I like actually listen to it, is how before you're born, your subconscious and your conscious states are fused perfectly, and then as you grow and you age, you begin to separate the two minds, and then the journey to enlightenment and trying to become that higher being is just trying to smash those two parts of your brain back together.
Yeah, we'll
and
actually
just,
talk.
And especially
about
the repeated part, the I know the pieces fit because I watched them fall away.
Yeah.
It's like I watched that crap brain. I know I saw how it was put together. I can do this shit.
Yeah, we'll actually talk a little bit about that during Ride Into 10,000 Days as well. I guess while this is loading, we can go ahead and talk about some of the imagery in the video. How many of you guys have seen it?
Not enough.
Alyssa, Jesse, they'll back me up. So basically in the video, you have these humanoid beings, and they're gray toned, but you kind of see their veins and muscular structure through their skin, almost transparent. And to me, that kind of represents the fact that some of us don't know how see-through we are. Like, we may not be aware of some of our own shortcomings, but they're totally obvious to others. And for those that see those in us and don't see them in themselves, it's often a projection, which complicates communication, because you're always looking for someone else to blame for a problem that's happening.
It tells you just more rawness.
Rawness,
and like not wanting things, like being truly touchy about things that you know wrong.
Sensitive.
And something on what you're saying, it seems like those who do see that in you oftentimes are people who had to go through that themselves and really turn that darkness into light for themselves. So in a way, it's a matter of communicating that external reflection to you and the patience so you can help yourself and help heal yourself internally.
And doesn't the song make allusions to Da Vinci's portions of man and the body and everything? So showing all the underlying structure of what they're actually talking about.
Yeah, and
maybe
the
not
album
human
art,
body, but
the album art for Lateralus is actually called the Dissectional. It's a series of transparencies that lays out the anatomy of the human body and its relation to the spirit and the divine. On one of the panels, within the brain is actually the word God. Also in the video, they are in a variety of positions. I mean, they're bobbing their heads upside down, which is obviously disorienting. And how can you pay attention to somebody else when you're so caught up in your own stuff that way? There's a part where we assume the female in this situation pulls the ear out of the male. And it's not just the ear, it's this whole block that comes out of his head. And so there's so much more beyond like the physical hearing that gets processed internally that goes into actually listening and understanding someone. And like there are parts when they're dragging each other across the room on their head, or constantly pushing them in a circle, trying to help them realize their own cycle or various things. I know Alyssa saw Tool on the Lateralis tour, bitch. And that there were actually aerial artists.
It was
the same people in the video, yeah.
And they were like swinging on ribbons. And
contorting their shoulders, dislocating. And that jealous of you.
Yeah. Alright, everyone collectively think Alyssa's a bitch and be jealous.
It's okay, I'm gonna let go of that grudge for my own sake. And then of course, at the end of the video, the
they
two beings form into one and then explode in a ball of fire.
And the fact that when they do become one, it looks so wrong. Like, it's kind of an eerie feeling. Where's
this
going?
Oh, and there's the little...
Yeah, the little guy. I forgot about the little guy. Yeah, there's this, like, vein or thing sticking out of her neck, and it gets pulled out of her, and when it drops, it takes on a life of its own and runs.
And there's a similar figure in most of the tools.
Yeah, most of the tools.
I see it as the demon that eats at people, and once it's removed, it would, like, just run onto someone else looking for another host.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's obvious significance to the fact that it was pulled from her neck.
Communication,
root
chakra.
Yeah.
All right, we'll see if it'll make
self-expression.
I'm glad someone else caught that advertisement.
Thank you. parabola of the human body shows the same mathematical proportion that you were talking about.
Also reminds me of the Egyptian
Standing
symbol.
Standing our heads against
the
each other.
The one holding the sky.
The what?
Reminds me of the Egyptian symbol of the one holding the sky. Holding the stars on the sky. Somebody got to make that prop.
Sounds like a fun day.
Well, it's like
Adam
is talking to this.
Adam and Chetzar did most of Mega.
Nice.
Adam directed all of their videos until Vicarious. And that was great.
I just like that sentence. All right, I need you to make me a block of gel with an ear on it. Listen close. Between the two polarities coming together and uniting. I never caught that before. So I was like, what's with this ring?
Okay, parable and parabola. I'm sure this song has literally saved countless lives. Like, pretty positive.
Stop in the middle of the road when it hits the crescendo, and I'm just like, holy shit.
We should.
Almost would cry. It's a good one.
Holy separation of living material from non-living waste.
Yes.
Or holy shit, as in shit that is holy. Shit being a general term for items. Just watch what they call the holy mountain. There's a part where, it begins with a man that he's just looking for gold. He's looking for the good stuff, basically. And this man puts him in an egg, and first he has poop in this glass bowl. And then he's burning the poop, he's cooking it, and he's pumping it into the egg this guy is meditating in. It's sealed other than the smoke from his poop. And the guy is just sweating, he's getting sick, and all this perspiration is coming out. Comes out, and he's holding a glass heart. It goes in through the blue tube, and the sweat comes out the red tube, a symbol of oxidation.
Whoa, that's cool.
And he pumps it back into the poop, and the poop turns to quartz and then to gold. And he gives him gold. And he says, this is what you wanted, but you must realize that you are extra man. And he shows him a mirror, and he gets pissed off, breaks the mirror, and he starts a transformation. George Harris said John Lennon funded the movie, and the whole thing from beginning to end is just like Lateralus in a movie. It's constant in your face messages.
Yeah. The guy that was trolling my status last night. I guess it might have been this morning. It was last night. He actually brought up that Sgt. Pepper is a nod to Aleister Crowley, that it was released exactly 20 years after Aleister Crowley's death, and it talks about 20 years ago to the day Sgt. Pepper taught us the way or something. I can't remember, but that was kind of interesting.
I'd say for certain it was about Aleister Crowley, but I don't want to get into this right now. The whole conspiracy of John really, or Paul really was dead. It was owed to him. The album cover is a funeral, if you look at it.
Yeah.
Which weirds me out, because that means that some guy got some serious plastic surgery or whatever. I don't know. I don't necessarily believe the thing. But there was some kind of serious death. They were falling.